So let's call to order ACID number one, October 12th.
Where's everyone shorts and flip flops?
That's right.
That's right.
John, but
these are Velcro.
Velcro tearaways.
And our first item on page one under tab one is to approve the minutes from the September 26th meeting.
So moved.
Is there a second? All those in favor? Minutes are approved. Are there any comments or questions from the public? Did anyone sign up?
No.
All right. Our next item is to conduct a public hearing on the proposed 2018 district tax rate, found under page 5, tab 2. And I need to call the public hearing to order, please. And John, if you wouldn't mind presenting the public hearing materials.
Matt Dunston and I will be addressing this, giving just a little bit of a map. I'll touch the broad areas and you can advise on our tax rate. We have, as of our last board meeting, you authorized a publishing of our proposed tax rate, and it was in the newspaper on August the 4th. I don't know if any of you saw that. Let me point out a couple things, just a basic chart of all the way back to 2002 through 2018 on terms of values. Our values of this year are right at $6,509,000,000, up just a little bit. And part of that story is there was some retrenching of values even after everything was certified last year. Is shown right here. Actually, this is the previous year, but let me show you what the result of that was. So we started out when we adopted the budget, when you adopted our budget this year in June, we forecast a appraised value, working with the appraisal district, of $6,580,000,000. That number, actually, our previous year was reduced. And so that made this number unattainable, and with some growth, certified values for levying our tax rate will be $6.509 billion of value. If we look at what that means in terms of you adopted a budget assuming a tax rate of what I would convert to 4.8 cents per $100 assessed value. And it looks like with these values just a little bit less than what we projected, that number will have to be 4.9 cents per $100 assessed value. And then where operating was going to be 9.5, it's going to be about 9.44. And the difference in that is about $100,000 of revenue. The budget was set up to have revenue exceed expenditures by about $270,000. So I think we can accommodate any small reductions in the operating revenue within that our existing budget. So if staff is proposing a tax rate of 4.9 for debt and 9.4 for a total of 14.35. And we'll try to answer any questions you have about that, and then put Matt Dunston, who's our financial advisor with RBC Capital. His primary function is to confirm that our proposed tax rate will in fact take care of our debt service.
One question. You have my handout in your packet.
One question. Go back to the chart before this.
Uh-huh.
Tell me what the assessed values were for the last few years.
Okay, let me go back here.
There.
All right. This gets a little hard to read.
Yeah, that's
what I said. In 2017, let me just sort of give you, I'll give you some forward years to go back. Let's go back 5 years. 2013, the total value in the area was $4.4 billion. The following year, it grew 16%. That growth right there was 19.8%. And 13% growth. So there's some very significant growth here. 14 went up 16%. 15, we're now at 5.6 billion and it's growing at 8.9%. In 2016, we're at 6.08 billion, and that's an 8.4% increase. And then last year was 6.5 billion. Shannon, is that the reduced number?
That is the reduced number. These numbers are kind of shifting, particularly from 16, 17, and possibly even 18 because of the lawsuit settlement. So those numbers were higher at one time, but as I get more update information, I'll go back and readjust it. So
this
we are
is,
still growing. Just
this is, let me look here if I see, no, I don't show it. But this 6.5 billion was actually a reduced number from what we had budgeted on and actually set our tax rate
and
on.
Actually certified. It goes back and
changes. And it has, so we had to accommodate that reduction of previous years and then have a slight increase. So where we're at, we were at 6.5, 1.117, 1.118, we're at 6.509, about $9 million.
What year was it? 4.5.
Excuse me.
What year was it? 4.5.
13, I think it was. 4.4. Well, let me to make sure you feel a little bit. In 2010, 3.2. 2011, 3.25. And 2012, 3.6, and then it really, these were like, that was actually a little backward growth, and then we started in 12, start really going at 13%, 19%, 16%, 9%, 8.5%, 6.8%, where we are today. So it went all the way from 2010 at $3.1 billion to today at 6.5, more than double.
Is that attributed to new development?
Some of that's new development. Probably the majority of it is
increased land prices,
the value of existing property. But there were significant development as well.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Matt?
Yeah. So I won't bore you with any of the details of what we went through, but we basically went through
page 5 in your book, right?
Yep. A similar analysis that focused just on your debt service fund and what tax rate is necessary in that fund to cover your debt for the upcoming year. We're just looking at the next 12 months. And a tax rate of 4.9 pennies is sufficient to cover your debt service payment next year, which is almost the highest payment of any debt service that you have currently forecasted. The next highest payment is just the next year in 2020. And then it declines from there gradually. So 4.9 pennies should be the highest debt service tax rate you need cover your debt through final maturity, and that's including this new bond that is in the market, has yet to close, but you've already priced today. And the analysis that I went through, as you can see on the second page of our report, just shows the starting point of your cash, adding the new levy at 4.9 pennies, at assuming a 99% collection rate, and then paying debt next year, ending with a balance of roughly 16% coverage of the following year's debt, which is low. We're trying to get that up to around 25%, which would be a 3-month reserve. And I believe we're transferring some money over from an operating fund to make the debt service fund a little healthier there. That helps your rating, it helps the market have comfort that there's some cash on hand to allow for maybe a bad year of collections or something. And then we end up with just a couple calculations on the bottom that show you the value of one penny and what the remaining tax rate is. So the rest of your tax rate is 9.445, which is for operations. But like I said, our primary focus is just on your debt. So we're comfortable at this level as your financial advisor.
I will add with the money that we think we can add to our debt service, even with this tax rate, we'll be getting up above 19%, almost 20%.
Yep.
Of reserve.
Any more to present?
We have nothing else, Mr. Chairman.
Any comments from the public during the public hearing? Okay, with that, let's adjourn the public hearing and then move on to our next item, which is to consider adopting order levying taxes of 2018.
on page 7 of your book, the order levying taxes is the formal action of the board establishing the tax rate for this year. There's really three operative sections. Section 1, you can see the tax rate, the total tax rate of 14.345 is established, as are the components of the tax rate, debt service, and operating. And then in Section 2, you're directing those funds into their proper accounts, debt service to the debt service account, operating tax to the operating account. And finally, Section 3 sets the delinquency date when taxes are delinquent, which is January 31 of 19.
Are there any comments or questions? If not, do I have a motion to adopt the order levying taxes found on page 7?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor? The order levying taxes is approved. Our next item is to consider amending the district information form and to authorize the appropriate action. Found on page 9.
The district information form is a document that we are required by state law to file in Harris County deed records. And what it does is it puts purchasers of property in this area on notice that we have tax, and that is used to pay for our outstanding debt. It lets people know what the amount of that debt is and what the tax rate is.
You basically get this closing notes.
That's right. Anybody that buys land in this area or any other district that has to publish one of these notices, this document is going to show up in the title work they do, and they'll be aware that they have to pay the tax before they purchase.
Any other questions or discussion? If not, may I request a motion to amend the district information form and to authorize the appropriate action?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Okay.
Okay, motion carries. That takes us to our next item, which is to consider authorizing an amendment to the contract between the district and Hess America for additional pedestrian pylon lights. This is found on page 13, tab 3.
Mr. Chairman, in April of 2016, the board awarded the Hess America a contract for fabrication of 280 pedestrian pylon lights that we are now installed and even some burning is down the boulevard.
They're beautiful, by the way.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Walk by through the trees and the pylons, first class.
Yeah, thank you. The cost per fixture was $15,700, and the total contract amount was $4.644 million. At that time, in 16, we probably underestimated the number of light fixtures we needed. Basically, what we had to do is go back in and work out explicitly where each one is located. They're on 40-foot centers. And we actually, through oversight, didn't include numbers in the two areas here. Up on the north end at the Post Oak Park, at Uptown Park, in this area here. And then down here where TxDOT's actually building the final piece of this. It would require an additional 34 lights. And we are also recommending that we create a attic stock of 16 fixtures, which would be about 5%. And so we are recommending that we purchase an additional 50 units at the original price, but a total amount of $785,000. And this will be paid for out of the capital budget for the management district. I'd be glad to answer any questions you might have, and if we could fix the blame on anyone, but it was probably our design team and ourselves have not. And in some of it was just simply unknowable until we get sort of down to this level.
Do you have a budget? Do you have a budget for this?
Yes, it's part of the. Capital budget, we did budget this year in our district budget. We knew we were short, and we just hadn't worked out price. The contractor was seeking some additional price increases, but Mr. Tobby was successful at getting the whole firm to his original cost.
Well, no, Mr. Collard. Do you want to add anything?
No, sir.
All right. Could we request a motion to authorize the amendment?
Motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay, the motion carries. That takes us to our last item, to receive the Post Oak Boulevard update.
We're not going to keep folks here very long, so I'll just tell you, you met 2 weeks ago. I think you can see the progress that's ongoing out there right now. Robert, anything you want to add for the end of this month? We should be trees being planted south of San Felipe. But we're starting to pour slabs for our transit stations. North of San Felipe, take a look. It's amazing what the seven rows of trees look like. Pretty exciting. Robert?
I think you should tell them about your acorn problem.
Well, we got a call that we had some mysterious stains that people felt like were coming up out of the ground on our new pavers. And upon review, it is the acorns from our live oak trees. A couple things. The explicit place where it was kind of the worst was a place where we had water running over the sidewalk from their private property irrigation. And those acorns were sitting on there and just putting this really beautiful olive green stain on it. We are going to keep that blown off. We are going to pressure wash and clean, and then we're going to put a sealer on it. So that should help. I thought Mr. Tobby got the acornless acorns.
I love the finest oats.
Lord, I'm
we're going to import squirrels in and take care of that.
Tara free squirrel.
Yeah. You know, if any of you have live oak trees up near your driveway at home, and this will be an issue, and it has always been an issue on sidewalks. And so we will manage it. But I think really this place, if those acorns are sitting there in the water, they really do shed the color real well. But the others, I think, it's manageable.
I apologize. Everything's going really well. Yeah, the problem down in Alabama is the primary going in, and it'll be done today. And Alabama will be.
Just don't know that.
What about on Westheimer and Post Oak? There's the traffic there's horrible.
There was something happened yesterday, but we could not find what that something was, but it was gone by the time.
It's about 1:30. I was in it myself, and I'm calling Robert screaming, but literally I came back and got up on the cameras, and it was
they may have done something there. They have the shafts in now for the tunnel that got to go underneath Westheimer again. And this time it's for the primary and communication. So
but
maybe they truck was blocked for a while.
If we, it's kind of, we do get down to one lane on occasion when a dump truck or something comes in. And it could have been that. It could have been a safety vehicle going through Westheimer and they change the signal and it gets out of sequence then. But I'll tell you, we couldn't find out yesterday what that problem was, because at Westheimer there was no problem. It was just we were backed up on West Oak Boulevard. Trying to monitor that.
So I don't know about anyone else here, but people are already starting to tell me how great the boulevard is looking.
Some of our more famous residents that live in Cosmopolitan have become big advocates for the beauty of the boulevard. And so, at least.
I hope they take due credit.
Count on
it. I'll tell you, I mean, if any of you haven't been to the north end and see how those trees look as on that curve, I can't wait to get down here. And here we are, Kendall's. Trees going in there, and if you'll notice at Masraff, Robert, I don't know if that was a pretty high trim on some of those there. So these trees are big enough that I think the retailers aren't going to drop.
Nice trees by Masraff's actually.
They really are.
They really are.
So we'll have a more, we'll probably do the West Loop piece with that TxDOT did. We'll fly the boulevard again, but you're seeing, we could point this out right now, I want you to just real quickly look at this. These are the bus lanes down by Fairdale, down towards Richmond. He's got it all the way up here and working. This is Post Oak between West Timer and San Felipe, and the bus lanes themselves are down about Ambassador Way now. And then this is up north, and as you say, not only do we have the bus lanes in, but the trees and the median, and they're still wrapped up. But they are actually starting to dig the foundations for the bus stations themselves, and they'll complete the bus lanes up to the West Loop probably in the next couple of weeks. So it's humming out there. The burn rate on the budgets past $3 million a month, I think. I think all of them have decided it's time to get completed and get out of the air.
Can't be excused.
We are adjourned.